Alright, welcome back to the single sign-on server and client installation tutorial. So far, we have installed the single sign-on server, configured it, and set up our first API key. Now let's install the first single sign-on client instance that uses the newly created API key. I'm going to go ahead and switch my tab, and you can see that I've preloaded the URL, which means that I still can't type. And I'm going to go ahead and start the installer. We can skip the first couple screens because they're information screens. And now we hit the compatibility checklist for the SSO client. Again, all of these here should be green yeses. And since I'm running locally on my own machine, I can get away with not doing over SSL since this is just a demo. But on a production environment, all green yeses. So just continuing on. On the next page are the fields that are required to be set up correctly for the client to operate properly. The system detects many of these different problem areas automatically, but it also helps to have a decent understanding of how web browsers interact with web servers. First, I'm going to switch back over to the SSO server admin, and I'm going to copy the endpoint URL, and I'm going to paste it into the endpoint URL box. I'm going to repeat this process for the API key. And also the secret key. Next, we have to decide how long we want our session to be good for. The default is 604,800 seconds, which translates to 7 days. This may or may not be the value that you want your sessions to last. So configure this however you want. You may have to use a calculator. There's also some help at the bottom, where you can see it automatically breaks it down how many days, hours, minutes, seconds your session length will be. So enter the number that you want here. The next step is to enter a cookie name that will be specifically for this particular single sign-on client instance. We'll just call this SSO My Web App. Oops. And I can't type as usual. Scrolling down, we can see that the yellow warning has changed to a green OK. And now we can move on to the SSO client cookie path. This messes people up a lot. The default cookie path is the path to the client where you're installing it. You probably don't want it to be this. You probably want it to be your application. Since I'm going to put my little test demo application one directory up, I'm going to go ahead and delete this. But perhaps you're installing it and you want it at the root of your website. Well, you'd get rid of all of this and you'd just do slash. And there also needs to be a trailing slash on the end of the path so that there aren't problems with certain browsers. And now we see that we get all green OKs across the board. But there are a couple other settings that are potentially worth considering, including how long you want the cookie to last, which has to be either zero or larger than the server session timeout. There is also the option to have the cookie be deleted from the web browser when the web browser is closed by setting the client cookie exit timeout to yes. I'm going to leave these alone, but you can set these however you want them to be set. The last option is how often the client will take the information that the web browser sent and then also initiate a request with the single sign-on server. This is part of the resiliency feature of the single sign-on server and client architecture, whereby the client doesn't have to talk to the server. So if the server sits on its own box, the client isn't always saying, hey, is this user valid? Hey, is this user valid? Hey, is this user valid? It just assumes that the user is valid for the amount of time that you specify. Now that we've gotten through all the required options, let's go ahead and proceed forward to the next page where we see some advanced options. These options are extra. They are not required for correct operation of the single sign-on client. However, you may want to do certain things. For instance, if your application is going to only run over SSL, you might want to enable the SSO client cookie over SSL only option, which will allow your application and the single sign-on client to operate entirely over SSL, which is obviously a good idea if you can do that, but not every application can. The other options on this page are of a similar nature. They either improve security or help customize the SSO client to your application's needs. I'm going to skip the rest of these as they are not needed for this demo. Let's just proceed on to the next page and install the software. Boom. Now the single sign-on client has been installed. The next step is to set up a test application to verify that the single sign-on client was installed correctly. Going over to the documentation under the Testing the SSO Client section, I see a couple of source code examples. I'm going to go ahead and copy this to my clipboard, switch over to my system here, and I'm going to create a file called test_oo.php. And I'm going to edit it, paste the code that was on my clipboard, save it, and now I'm going to go back over to my web browser, testoo.php. Now you will note that the URL has changed to a URL that includes the SSO server. So we've gone from the client to the server, and we're seeing the generic login system. It doesn't look very nice, but it does work. We'll cover fixing this up in the next video, but I want to spend the remainder of this video going over what TestOO actually is doing. The first four lines need to be executed as early as possible in the web application so that the single sign-on client can do important things, such as being able to handle a user filling out a form, hitting submit, getting redirected to the single sign-on server and coming back, but then proceeding as if they had just submitted the form. So a very important feature of the single sign-on client is being able to continue where the person left off. Where the rest of the code lands doesn't matter as much, but those first four lines should be as early as possible. Moving along, the next bit of code handles impersonation tokens and remote login support within the single sign-on server. These are passed along on the URL to the single sign-on server so that it can handle the request. On the next line, we see a test to see if the user is logged in or not. And if they are not logged in, then the client is directed to initiate a login session with the server. And this is where we are sitting currently on the single sign-on server over in the web browser. After the user is logged in, the next bit of code extracts fields from the single sign-on server or the encrypted protected session information and puts that information into an easy-to-consume object. The next line of code tests whether or not the user has the right level of access. In this case, the code is only allowing single sign-on site admin users through. I'm going to go ahead and comment this out to simplify the next video. Beyond this point is the sample code for the test application. If you are building your own web application, everything above this point might go into a user.php file, and you would include or require the user.php file from your own code. We'll see the results of the rest of this code in the next video. In the next video, I will show how to make this login screen look nicer, create a user account, sign in, and lock down the admin interface using another SSO client installation.